We'll take one of the cheap ones.
Okay, right. Yeah. Yeah, so how can Japan make an atomic bomb in just 5 minutes? That's the question, right?
Is it possible? Is it literal 5 minutes, or is it meaning that preparation? Their readiness.
Okay, we'll come. This is the second part of the question. Right now, 5 minutes. The answer is yes. It's actually possible for them, literally or not. We'll come to that later on.
Okay.
Now, what's actually required for making an atomic bomb? That's that has to be our focus.
Yeah, yeah.
6.5 euros.
Oh, okay.
So it's not expensive.
6.5 euros is okay.
Yeah, food, 15 euros maximum.
Yeah, price. I mean, yeah, money is okay. Yeah, problem is time.
1 day, 20 euros. You're set.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're having. Yeah, please.
Yeah. So
the bomb.
Okay.
Welcome to our
I'm not into this.
Okay. give me this for the.
Yeah.
Okay.
Welcome to our televisions.
We'll even be putting this on the YouTube so people can know how to make an atomic bomb for sure. Yeah. But then the material which they actually require will not be, you know, so hand. I mean, into the hand. So it's that's going to be a problem. Okay. So what exactly is a atomic bomb? You know.
Yeah.
That has to be the first question.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you take some fissile material, keep them all together so that there is a sustained chain reaction.
Mm-hmm.
If you are able to sustain a chain reaction, that means once a neutron breaks, it breaks into two parts, and then it also releases three neutrons.
Mm-hmm.
One of these three neutrons should go and hit another nucleus and should be able to cause fission into that.
Mm-hmm. Fission.
Yes. Only if this chain continues, if every one reaction gives rise to the other reaction, or maybe if it multiplies, then that's going to be something like a chain reaction. So there has to be a chain reaction, a sustainable chain reaction. How would you make it possible for a sustainable chain reaction to sustain? Now the solution for that is, if you take some fissile materials, like for example, if you take some uranium fissile material, that is uranium-235, and you place it in the shape of a pen, what exactly will happen? Suppose if there is a nuclear reaction taking place on this end of the pen, that means if one of the nucleus over here on this end disintegrates, it's going to release like at an average 2.3 or maybe 3 neutrons, right? So which directions can the neutrons travel? It can travel in this direction, that direction, maybe towards other fissile materials. It can travel anywhere. Because the spin is in a shape, in a linear shape, so there is a high chance that almost all of the neutrons are going to be going to escape in this direction where there is no fissile material. Right? So now this linear shape is not so good idea for making for sustaining a chain reaction. Now let's change the model. Suppose we make a square. It becomes like if there is a nuclear reaction taking place at the center of the square, then there are equal chances, like not very equal chances, but towards the edge it's going to be more, but towards the sides it's going to be lesser, right? Edge where there is a cone, corner, it's going to be higher because it has to traverse through so many material. And towards the surfaces, it's going to be lesser. But if we make it like a circle, a spherical ball, then you know there's going to be an equal probability. So same material, if you make if you make it into a ball, so if there's a neutron reaction, if there's a nuclear reaction taking place at the center or somewhere around, it has equal probability. This circular ball has the highest probability of all of sustaining a chain reaction. It's the concept of a nuclear weapon. So now, if you have a ball which has the highest chance of sustaining a chain reaction, again the question is how much material you need to have all together in order to sustain a reaction. You have, right now as the first step, we have understood the very first criteria, that is the shape criteria. We have understood that circular shape, or maybe to be very direct, spherical shape is going to be the most, you know, efficient way of sustaining a chain reaction.
Yeah.
Now, if we make a small ball, again, you know, a neutron, if I fire a bullet, and if I have like only 5 people, there are some chances that my bullet may miss and not hit anyone. But if I have like 50 people, it's a chance that someone is gonna, the probability is higher. So there is a concept of a critical mass. Now what this critical mass is, if you add some more fissile atoms, like uranium-235, so we can be very sure about the hit. you know, the probability of getting a hit into one of the nucleus by this neutron increases exponentially by having. So there is a there is one mark wherein we can say that for a circular geometry or for a spherical geometry, this kilogram of uranium-235, which it's different for different materials, or this kilogram of plutonium-239, will make sure that a chain reaction is sustained. So once you accumulate that amount of material in a circular geometry, that becomes a bomb. So once you attain a chain reaction by making it a spherical ball and then bringing the correct amount of material which is actually required to sustain a chain reaction, that is known as critical mass, altogether, then your bomb is done.
This is the bomb.
That's it. You just assemble it and that's the bomb. It will blast that then and there itself. So, why would a bomb blast? For example, a country A needs to throw this bomb to some country B. I mean, what is the certainty that this bomb is not going to explode here at your own place, and it's going to explode somewhere else, like the place where you're going to hit? So we keep it in such a way that it doesn't form a critical mass. Like for example, if we have, by some complex mathematical calculation, numerical analysis, if we have found that, you know, 1 kilogram of uranium-235, it's actually 5 kilogram for plutonium, and maybe like 10 to 12 kilogram for uranium-235. So if by some complex algorithm, some calculations, we have found out that 5 kilograms of plutonium can actually sustain a chain reaction, so what we are going to do is that we are going to keep it in such a way that it never becomes 5 kilogram.
It's less than that.
It's always less than that. And we make it 5 kilogram only when it is actually required to, where we want to blast it. So we put the thing into our delivery system, like a missile system or a jet plane or something like that, and then we fire it, and only when it reaches the destination,
it becomes 5.
And once it becomes 5, you see Hiroshima Nagasaki. So now, can a country make, you understood the basics of like atomic weapons, right? Now the question is, can a country make a nuclear weapon in like five minutes or so? The solution is, where are you going to get the uranium-235 from? Or where are you going to get the plutonium-239 from now? Let's get to some facts. Uranium-235 is the only fissile material which is actually available to us, which is actually found on the Earth. If you go for any other fissile material, it's not possible. Uranium-239, which is also a fissile material, is actually formed in a nuclear reactor. You don't have it here, you don't find it here on the Earth surface, because the half-life is something like 22,400 or something like that, 24,000 years. So since the beginning of the Earth, since the Big Bang theory, it has actually been decaying, and right now nothing of that sort has been left. So we can only create that by bombarding uranium-238 by a neutron and then converting it into plutonium-239. So that is how you get plutonium. In order to get plutonium, you need to have a nuclear reactor. Only then you can extract. And you know, okay, that is number one. Number two is, if you try to make a uranium bomb, which is actually easier in this case, uranium-235 is only like 0.762 or 768% in the nature. This is known as natural uranium.
0.76.
Yes. What happens is, if you dig a mine of uranium somewhere in Canada, by the corporation, or somewhere in Australia, what happens is this uranium which you get is only 0.762% or 768% fissile atom. That is uranium-235. The rest, that is like 99.3%, is actually non-fissile.
You need to separate that.
That is uranium-238. If we hit a uranium-238 with a neutron, it becomes 239, and then it undergoes some beta emission, and finally it becomes like, it takes like 2 days in a nuclear reactor to become plutonium, which again becomes a fissile form. And you should know for sure that like 30% of the electricity or the power which is generated inside a nuclear reactor is actually caused by the plutonium, because so now two things are going to be required. If they don't have a nuclear reactor, they can go for enrichment of uranium-235. Enrichment is actually a very, 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 very and a very costly affair. So like, you make some centrifuges. What you do is that you convert the uranium into uranium hexafluoride, UF6 gas, and you feed the feed the UF6 gas into a centrifuge, you rotate the centrifuge. Now this uranium hexafluoride is actually not uranium hexafluoride, it is uranium-235 hexafluoride and uranium-238 hexafluoride. Uranium-238, because of the molecular mass is higher, so it's going to be like heavier. So there is going to be some separation between, once it rotates, one is going to be much more excited, so it's gonna, there's going to be some separation. That is how it's going to be. But the separative work unit is so less, like, you know, for example, for if you run like hundreds of enrichment centrifuges altogether, it's only like 1 to 2% or 3% at max. So it's very, and the electricity which you feed in to make the keep that route, and the rotation speed is also like 20,000 rotations per minute or so, per second, I think. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very high. Only even then you get like how. So that's one process. So that's very difficult and very costly, time consuming, everything, right? The second thing is, although enrichment plants are actually required, because if you want to feed a light water reactor, you have to go for an enrichment plant. Because light water reactors use some fuel which has enrichment of something like 4 to 5%, right? And only a PHWR uses, which India has, only a PHWR uses some fuel which is PHWR fuel, which is like natural uranium fuel, right? So the countries have enrichment technology, but still we have to enrich it to like 90%, only then the critical mass is going to come down. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, if you try to make an atomic bomb using natural uranium, it's going to be like 5,000 kilogram bomb. Mm-hmm. How can you drop 5,000 kilogram, or maybe more than that? Yeah, I couldn't make the calculation right now. But in order to reduce the critical mass, that is what the concept is. We have to reduce the critical mass. So in order to reduce the critical mass, you have to enrich the fuel in uranium-235. Mm-hmm. So enriching it in uranium-235 is actually a costly affair. Mm-hmm. Now, second, what if a country tries to go for a plutonium bomb? It actually needs to have a reactor. So since a country, now we're going back to the second part of the question, since it's a country like Japan or South Korea, which do not have a weapon, but actually it has been having nuclear reactors since long, like 50 years or so.
Yeah, lots of nuclear reactors.
So they have already accumulated so much of plutonium, which they can.
It's already there.
Yes. Now, another question comes in here. There are two types of plutonium, which can be actually, there's a plutonium extraction process, Urex process, Purex process, and all those things, chemical solvent extraction process. All those things are there, which are actually involved with, which actually take care of the taking out the plutonium stream from the spent fuel or something like that. But now the thing is, there are two types of plutonium. One is a weapon grade plutonium, and the second one is a reactor grade plutonium. The plutonium which you get out of a normal operating reactor is a reactor grade plutonium, because they have some daughter cells, or so they have some atoms which are actually very hard gamma emitters. So you can make a bomb out of that, you know. The second thing is that it's also going to heat. It has to be actually quiet. It should be very less gamma emitter, or else it will say, hey, I'm a bomb here. Hey, I'm a bomb. I'm over here. It's going to say that. Okay? It's going to point towards itself. So that's not required. So this cannot be used, and it can only be used for a nuclear reactor, to run a reactor, or to make a MOX fuel or something. The second, for making a bomb, you know, there's a special type of plutonium which is needed, which you will get if you make a research reactor. If you radiate that fuel for only like 1 to 2, very short period, like 1 to 2 months, and then take it out and then reprocess it. Mm-hmm. That way you can get a plutonium which is like, which is a weapons grade plutonium. Mm-hmm. If you go for a long run, like 1.5 years or 2 years, if you just put in the reactor fuel and you take it out, that's going to be a reactor grade plutonium. So in order to make a weapons grade plutonium, you have to take the fuel rod, put it inside a reactor for like 1 and 1.5 months, because the chemical composition, everything changes, right? Mm-hmm. We need to have our chemical composition, which we actually require for making the bomb. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's like that. So they can make it in like 5 minutes, provided that they have they have the weapon grade plutonium. Because if they have the weapon grade plutonium, the only thing they have to do is to assemble it to a critical mass, to a critical shape, critical mass, and it explodes. Now, there is a third question which comes into figure, which is the most important question. If you make a critical mass using some two half masses, like half critical masses each, once you try to bring them, bring